Good morning, Due West. My name is Matt Belaine, and I'm the Director of Media and Communications here at the church. If you're joining us online, we encourage you to come and join us in person if you are able. There's nothing quite like gathering together with your sisters and brothers. As we prepare to worship this morning, here are a few things to remember. The homecoming celebration for Due West's 50th birthday is September 10th, which, if you look at the calendar, is only 2 weeks away. It is incredibly important that the homecoming committee knows how many people will be attending so that we can prepare any extra seats or viewing areas that might be needed. Make sure to register through Church Center today. Ignite will not be meeting today or next Sunday. We will meet again on September 10th. Fans in the Stands is a program for Due West families and Due West fans. We want to support your family by having Due West fans show up to your child's sporting event, theater production, band concert, you name it. If you're interested in learning more, check out this week's insight. Sarah Grace McDowell is again collecting shoes to fund her mission trip to Costa Rica. Today is the last Sunday for shoes to be left in the white donation bin. Is Christmas your favorite holiday? Do you want to work on a short-term mission project that has a global impact? Then Operation Christmas Child is the perfect mission for you. Please contact Millie Skinner for more information. Join choir for the fall. We are preparing for our homecoming service and for our morning of worship through song service in September. We only have a few rehearsals, so join in on this exciting time. Next, we are initiating a new orchestra scholarship fund. If you are looking for a place to invest in the future of young musicians, this is a great place to start. Please see the music website to donate. Waymaker Women's Center is putting on a fundraising ride to support mothers called Steel Horse Ride for Life. If you or anyone you know rides a motorcycle, please encourage them to register for this event. Waymaker knows how hard every rider works to fundraise for the program, so they want to celebrate your achievements. Every dollar raised by the ride community makes a difference. Riders are encouraged to raise donations through ride sponsors, and prizes will be given to the top three fundraisers. To register, go to the Waymaker website on screen and click on Events in the top left of the page. Finally, the called conference is today for our church-wide vote. Doors will open at 3 p.m., registration starts at 3:15, and doors will close promptly at 4 p.m. Nursery will be available for anyone who needs it, so be sure to come and let your voice be heard. Now, prepare your hearts for worship.
All right. We're about to jump into worship, but I'm going to invite, as we get started with this song, if you haven't picked up your preschool age child, they're welcome to stay and sing with us, but they might want to go back to their seats and sit with their parents as well.
Also, Miss Kunkel is in the back. If you want to send them to Miss Kunkel, she'll take them downstairs to our children's area.
Thank you, boys and girls. That was so beautiful. Yay. I want to invite you to stand as you're able as we worship the Lord this morning, singing the song, that great Wesley hymn, "And Can It Be That I Should Gain?"
And can it be that I should gain? Amen. Thank you. And would you remain standing as we affirm our faith together, saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
It's so great to have you all this morning. It's a joy right now to invite our preschool director and assistant director, Shelley Kubek and Courtney Kunkel, to come up on preschool Sunday. So, ladies.
Thank you, David. So today is preschool Sunday. What a great job our kids did. Give them a hand. And I want to thank Miss Nancy, our music teacher. She's up here. And all our teachers who helped us get them down to the stage. Thank you, ladies. They do more than that, though. And we're just so excited to have our preschool families here today. And, of course, my name is Shelley Kubek. I'm the current director of the preschool. I just want to take this opportunity to give a brief overview of the preschool. So just so you know, the Due West Methodist Church had been caring for children for a very long time. So it started back in the 90s after a search. They hired Karen Coffeen, who is with us here today. She spent the next 8 months contacting other preschools in the area, going to classes, interviewing, hiring staff, registering students, and setting up the program. The Due West UNC Preschool Ministry officially began in September of 1995. It consisted of Karen, of course, and seven other teachers. And actually, Miss Nancy Alfieri, who is still on our staff today, is one of those. And also many of our staff members were hired by Karen. So, after the 28-29 school year, Ms. Coffeen retired, after 24 years, and then Michelle Davalos took over as our director. Today, our preschool is led by myself and Ms. Kunkel. It takes two of us now. Where'd she go? Oh, there she is. Takes two of us now because we have all kinds of offerings. We have kindergarten classes. We even had a first grade during the COVID-19 pandemic. We currently have 190 students with over 30 staff members. This preschool would not exist, though, without Karen Coffeen. Karen took a discipleship class, and a result of that class, she felt God's calling to start the preschool. She built this school from hard work and dedication. She lived the mission of the ministry by offering a secure, nurturing, and early learning experience within a Christian setting. She made sure to live out the love of Jesus. We are privileged to have this opportunity to provide this to the families of West Cobb. So on our 28th year, we want to honor Karen Coffeen. She's probably surprised a little bit, but we're going to establish the Karen Coffeen Character Award. Karen and Bill, will you come join me up front? Bill, this award will be voted on at the end of each school year and given annually. This year we had a small committee that helped create the award, and so we do have our first recipient of the award today. The recipient of this award will be someone who upholds the Christian values of the school and lives out the gospel in the community by being an example for all. But before, Ms. Kunkel is going to announce it, but before that, I wanted to let you know, Courtney and I did some rough math. We're not mathematicians, but we think Karen has, with this ministry, we've reached over 5,000 children that have heard the word of Jesus. So thank you. I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Kunkel, and she is going to give the Karen Coffey Character Award first recipient.
Okay, our first recipient of the Karen Coffey Character Award goes to a woman Karen hired back in 1995, the first year of the preschool. She is celebrating her 28th year as a teacher. She has taught in our 2s, 3s, 4s, and kindergarten classes. She has seen a lot in 28 years of teaching. She moved with the preschool into this building when Due West bought it. She taught through a pandemic. She goes by many names at the preschool, Miss Fairy, Miss Appleberry, and of course, Miss Alfieri. Miss Nancy Alfieri is a wonderful example of a teacher who upholds Christian values. She is loved by the staff, children, and parents as someone who genuinely cares for them. She is patient and loving to every child in her class, as well as any child in the preschool, past and present. She has taught over 350 children in our community about their ABCs, 1, 2, 3s, and how much Jesus loves them. My own 3 children were blessed to have her as their 4-year-old teacher. She lives out the gospel to our community by showing love, patience, compassion, and kindness to everyone she meets. Miss Alfieri, you are a true legacy and blessing to our preschool. Thank you for showing God's love to the children of our community. Join me in congratulating the first recipient of the Karen Coffey Character Award, Miss Nancy Alfieri.
Thank you. What a joy in the life of the church. Oh, go ahead.
Thank you all so much. I just want to thank Shelley and Courtney and the entire preschool staff for today and for all that they do. You guys, ladies, don't go far if you would. So if you're a current preschool family, would you just kind of raise your hand? Thank you guys so much for being here. We talk about long-term impact. They talked about thousands of kids. If you have ever been in the preschool or had a child or a grandchild in the preschool, would you raise your hand? Look around. That's the impact of this ministry. So thank you all so much for what you do. Shelley and Courtney, would you ladies come back up and kneel at the altar for me if you would? Sam, I want them up here just on behalf of the preschool. But preschool staff stand up. Make sure that everybody sees you guys that are here. Thank y'all for being here. And would our families stand up? Preschool families stand up. I believe in laying on hands to pray for people. Scripture speaks of that a lot. So we're going to lay hands on Shelley and Courtney and pray for them and for the preschool. If you would, just as an expression of that in the congregation, just kind of reach out your hand towards these families, towards this staff, and let's pray together. Gracious God, we are so thankful for all the work that has been done. Lord, we thank you for Karen and her vision. We thank you for the decision of the church so many years ago. We thank you for the continued godly leadership that this school has today. Lord, for every teacher today, every person on the staff today, every child, every family, we give you thanks. Lord, for all that have passed through this place, we give you thanks. Father, we thank you for the legacy that is Due West Preschool. And we pray from today through the next 28 years and beyond, you will continue to do great and mighty things in this place, in this ministry, and we pray more than anything that your children would continue to hear and experience the love of Jesus in this place. For it is in his name we give you thanks. It is his name that we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Thanks, Shelley. Thank you. Please be seated.
Wonderful. What a joy in the life of the church. As we continue together in worship, I want to draw a couple more items to your attention, joys and concerns. We want to thank everyone last week who showed up after the service in the heat to help out with the church workday. We're so grateful for those efforts, and the church campus looks that much better as a result. Also, weekly communion has been well received, and we're grateful for that. So following, if you would like to receive communion today, you can do so by heading out to the gathering room following the service. There will be a communion service, and that's offered every week. So when we don't have communion here, we will have it following the service. And so we're grateful for that means of grace to all that choose to participate. Also, our Center for the Arts has been busy, and they did another Parents' Night Out, and so we're grateful for that, to give our parents a break, but also to give our youth some good volunteer hours as well. And our Waymakers Women's Center celebrated the birth of another child. I think we have a picture of it here. Yes! Oh my goodness. As if you didn't already have enough cuteness overload for today, this little 3-pound, 13-ounce baby girl. She was a little early, so we want to make sure we keep her and mom in our prayers, but we're so grateful and want to keep all of those women in our Waymakers Center in our prayers as well. And in terms of concerns, we want to pray for Charlie Cobb and his family following the passing of his father somewhat unexpectedly. So we want to pray for Charlie Cobb and his family. We're going to turn to the Lord in prayer, and if you would, we're going to start with a time of silent prayer. This is an opportunity to present whatever joys and concerns you have to the Lord, and then I will lead us in a prayer together. Would you pray with me? Kind Father, we're so thankful for your faithfulness at work in our midst, Lord, for our preschool and families and children. Lord, thank you for the good work that you're doing in each of their lives. Continue to strengthen our teachers and staff and our parents. Lord, continue to strengthen and encourage them. Lord, we thank you for the good work being done in and through our church. Besides, Lord, for those who have helped out with the workday, Lord, for our Center for the Arts, God, for our Waymakers Women's Center, Lord, thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your faithfulness and your blessing, Lord. We celebrate your work in our midst. And Lord, we know that there is seasons of loss as well, and we want to lift up those who are grieving in this time, particularly Charlie Cobb and his family. We ask you to pour out your grace and your compassion and your mercy on this family in their time of need. And Lord, in all of this, we thank you that you have shown yourself good and trustworthy, faithful to answer prayer, faithful for whatever needs we might bring to you. Lord, we bring those needs, personal and private. God, we know that you know and you hear each and every prayer. Lord, we lift up our church to you. We pray that we as a church will continue to trust you, continue to walk faithfully in stride and in faith with you. We pray for our leaders. We pray for our pastor, David. Lord, anoint his words once again. And give us willing hearts and minds that we would receive your word proclaimed to us and respond in faith. Lord, thank you. We pray during this time together that we would be strengthened and empowered to go forth and to be the church that you have called us to be. And so with that in mind, we pray the prayer that you have taught your disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. We would invite the ushers to now come forward for a time of the giving of our tithes and offerings. And you'll see, we're always trying to highlight some of the various things that go on in the life and ministry of the church. We've got some pictures of our latest men's annual golf tournament. And so it was hot, which the pictures do not necessarily indicate, but it was a great time. And we're thankful for our men and the ministry that God is doing through them. Would you pray with me over the offerings? Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you for your generosity towards us. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for the generosity of this community. God, we ask that you would bless everything that's given today, here and other services online. Lord, let it further your kingdom and let it glorify your name. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
You are.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Again, good morning. So glad you're all here this morning. Before we read our scripture, just a couple of things. What you all in the congregation do not know, I want to express my gratitude to Alicia Isles, our children's director, and our whole children's staff. They had kind of an open house during Sunday school, so any of our preschool families that wanted to come and just check that out were able to. So I'm grateful for them doing that. One more thing, as you heard in the announcement video, we do have a vote for the church this afternoon. I spoke about that last Sunday at the end of the service, and I won't repeat all of that, other than just a reminder of what Jesus said. Love one another as I have loved you. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. So wherever you stand, however things go this afternoon, we always show love and respect to one another, because that's who we are as the body of Christ. Tomorrow, thank you. Amen. Yeah. That's who God has called us to be, and that is who we are. Tomorrow morning, the building's still going to be standing. There could be some bruised feelings in it all, so there'll be some time of healing. But also tomorrow morning, we will be about the business of being the Church of Jesus Christ, because that, again, is who we are. All right, so just as a reminder for that. Our scripture this morning is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, starting with verse 33. If you have your Bibles, Mark chapter 9, verse 33. Or as always, it's on the screen. And this is what it says. They came to Capernaum. When he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the road?" But they kept quiet, because on the way they had been arguing about who was the greatest. Sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, "Anyone who wants to be first must be the very last and the servant of all." He took a little child, whom he placed among them. Taking them in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me does not welcome me, but the one who sent me." Let's pray. Gracious God, open our hearts this morning. Open our ears. Speak to us from your word, in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're in our fourth and final week of this series called Fail. And I've tried to start every week with stories of just kind of personal fails for my own life. And I want you to know that we didn't limit this series to 4 weeks because I was running out of stories of personal failures. All right. I could keep this up a long, long, long time. But we're moving on to something else next week. So this is, I got a lot more, but this is the last one you get to hear. This one deals with one of our children. My wife and I have 3 children. Our son, some of you know our son, Jay. He's now 28, which is hard to believe. Jay cannot hear or cannot speak. He's been that way all of his life. He can make a lot of sound. He can get your attention, but he can't articulate words. So he communicates using American Sign Language. So that's how our family talks with our son, is American Sign Language. He's been that way all his life. There's a long medical explanation. I'll spare you that. But just know that we never bothered to tell Jay that he was limited because of his disability. So he just goes about life and does what he wants to do and handles things. As case in point, not too long ago, he came and he said in sign language, "My air conditioner, you know how hot it is." He said, "My air conditioner doesn't work." I was like, "Well, thank God it's not my car. What are you going to do, son?" He said, "I'll take it to the car guy." I said, "Good plan." So he goes to the mechanic. He types on his phone, "Air conditioner not work." Jay finds ways to communicate. He's great at that. So they fix this car. He paid him. He just goes through life and handles things. He's great. Well, I tell you all that so you understand that. I understand a little bit about our son. A few months ago, he came home from work, and he, again, in sign language, said he had fallen at work and his side hurt. Well, you know, I'm a dad. I'm a loving, compassionate dad. And so what did I say? Go take some Advil, go back to work. Suck it up. I mean, you don't lay around just because your side hurts a little bit. Go back to work. This is who we are, son. This is what we do. And so that was a Monday. That's what he did. He went back to work, and he worked all week. And Jay has a physical job and, you know, picks things up, moves things around. It's a week later. He's back at work, and again, through his phone, he's communicating to his coworkers. His side still hurts. Now, remember, he fell at work, and they know this. So they're now starting to think, okay, we need to make sure, you know, for their liability, we need to make sure that he's okay. So they send him to the doctor. His employer sends him to the doctor. He goes to the doctor, and the doctor, of course, says, oh, he's fine. Oh, just one little thing. He's got a broken rib. The kid worked all week long hard, worked hard with a broken rib because his loving, compassionate pastor father said, suck it up, son. And that's how I won my Parent of the Year award. But that is a parenting, that's what you call a parenting fail, right? We've all had those times when we did something and we look back and we just know, shouldn't have done that. That was a fail. Well, we've been looking at some fails in the Gospels, fails of the disciples, those followers of Jesus. There were a lot of them. The disciples failed quite a bit. But we're not just looking at their failures. We're looking at how God works in and through them in those failures and what God does. So this morning we are in Mark chapter 9. We were in Mark chapter 9 actually a couple of weeks ago if you were here. It was the story of the man who had a son possessed by an evil spirit. If you have children, you have at one time or another wondered if they were possessed by an evil spirit, right? This man's son actually was possessed by an evil spirit. He brings the boy to the disciples in hopes the disciples can cast out the evil spirit, but they are unable. Jesus shows up, casts out the evil spirit, and calls them out, thinks they should have done it. That was a fail. We talked about that. Following that, Jesus calls the disciples off alone and speaks of his impending death. Not the first time that happens. It happened in chapter 8, happens again in chapter 9. So Jesus cast out the evil spirit, talks to the disciples about his death, and then it says this in verse 32. But they did not understand what he meant and were afraid to ask him about it. They were afraid to ask him all this death talk. So that ends kind of that part of the story, and then our passage picks up. In between, they've made a walk to the village of Capernaum. Capernaum is a fishing village on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. Now, it was, in Jesus' earthly ministry, his home base. It was his home base. He was born where? Bethlehem, right? Raised where? Nazareth, that's right. But if he had a home as an adult, it was Capernaum. Capernaum. You say, now, where did you get that from? I read it ages ago in a book. I'm trying to think of what book it was. The Gospel of Mark was the name of that book. All right, this is the Gospel of Mark, chapter 2, verse 1. A few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. It's home. That's chapter 2. We're in chapter 9. He goes back to Capernaum, home base. They've been walking. They walked everywhere. And he was apparently a little ahead, a little behind. They get there and they go into a house. We don't know whose house. We know for sure Simon Peter lived in Capernaum, could have been there. But they're in a house, and Jesus says, what were you arguing about as we walked along the road? He could hear them. In other words, boys, your conversation sounded a little tense. You're not talking politics again, are you? I told you not to talk politics. Maybe you're talking NFL, or you're trying to figure out why the Falcons got absolutely crushed Friday night in preseason. I mean, what are you arguing about? And they say, we cannot tell a lie. We were arguing about who was the greatest. Actually, they don't do that at all, right? They are ashamed. They are embarrassed. They remained silent because they were talking about who among them was the greatest. As a reminder, they are walking with Jesus, who is the greatest, not Muhammad Ali. Jesus is the greatest. But they're back in the back having this little, well, which one of us is the greatest? I think you're no higher than number 7. You might be a 4. I'm number 1. I mean, they're arguing, which one of us is the greatest? How long had they listened to Jesus talk about humility? How long had they listened to Jesus talk about service to others? How long had they listened to Jesus talking about loving your neighbor? And how do they spend their time? Which one of us is the greatest? I'm in a Wednesday morning men's group, and we just finished a book called A Long Obedience in the Same Direction. It's by Eugene Peterson. It's a great book. It has 16 chapters. Chapter 13 is on humility. Humility. At the end of chapter 12, looking at the title for chapter 13, some of the guys said, I might skip next week. I'm already great at humility. Now, they were kidding. At least most of them were. A couple of them, I think, were serious. But you can laugh at it, but that's where the disciples are. They think they're already great at humility. Which one of us is the greatest? Not only had they heard Jesus talk about all this stuff, they had watched Jesus live it all out. They had seen him exemplify it. What were you arguing about as you walked along the road? And they were silent because it had been a fail. See, you got to remember, when we operate out of our own pride, when we operate out of our own ego, as a rule, we're setting ourselves up to fail. I mentioned this a while back, but there was a podcast, Christianity Today did a podcast a while back called The Rise and Fall of Mars Hill. Now, it's not the Mars Hill Road a little west of here. It's not the Mars Hill in Athens, Greece, although if you've never been to Mars Hill in Athens, you really ought to go. It's a cool place. But it's a church in Seattle, Washington. Mars Hill started in 1996 as a home Bible study. So imagine, if you can, in 1996, a bunch of people get together in a home for a Bible study, and in a few years, that explodes into a church of 15 different campuses scattered across 4 different states. The church absolutely exploded. It was huge. They were one of the first churches in the country to make their sermons available for download, to listen to on the internet. Before, now we all do that, but before anybody was doing that, they started doing that. 20 years ago, they were getting 250,000 downloads a week. That's a lot today. 20 years ago, 250,000 downloads a week. I won't get that in my lifetime, all right? They got it every week. The church was exploding. You'd think, you know, everything is going great, except it wasn't. Because in leadership, you had people operating out of ego, as you listen to the podcast, people operating out of pride and power and control. When people on staff voiced opposition, they would be fired. When church members asked questions, they would be ostracized. Because the ego driving the train, that group, in that group, the ego driving the train controlled everything. And from the outside looking in, it might have looked like everything was going okay, but it was crumbling from within. In less than 20 years, barely over 15 really, this church that had exploded closed its doors. You remember what it says in Proverbs chapter 16? Pride goes before a what? Fall. There was a lot of pride, and there was a great fail. Ego, pride will lead us to a fail. As I was listening to the podcast, I thought about the contrast with the ministry of the late Billy Graham. Billy Graham became well known in the 50s and was a household name for decades and decades. Counseled presidents for decades. Filled stadiums to listen to him preach before you could actually download a sermon. People would come out live and fill stadiums. Preach on TV to people all over the world. I would think statistically nobody has preached the gospel to more people than Billy Graham. You can see how his ego could have gotten away with him. But did you ever hear a hint of scandal? Did you ever hear a hint of ego? Early on, in his ministry in the 50s, he surrounded himself with people, with policies and procedures to protect from that. And so he managed decades and avoided it. When you look at Mars Hill, you're reminded that pride goes before a fall. But when you watch Billy Graham, you're reminded that a humble spirit will help you avoid a fail. A humble spirit will help you avoid a fail. The disciples were missing that in this scripture. They were too busy arguing about who was the greatest. Now, every week, as I've said, we've looked at the disciples and some of their failures. But as I've said before, all through the Bible, there are plenty of stories of other people who failed. Old Testament is filled with that. And the Gospels have other accounts, not just disciples, but other fails, primarily among the religious people, the Pharisees, the Sadducees. You see a lot of fails in the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and you start to see a common thread. There's a story in the 12th chapter of Matthew's Gospel where there's someone possessed by a demon, and Jesus comes along and casts the demon out. Well, the Pharisees are watching this, and they can't believe that he can do something they can't do. They can't do that. How is he doing that? They can't believe he has power they don't have. They can't believe he knows something they don't know, because their ego is driving everything. So you would think that they would be excited that there was one less demon in the neighborhood, right? You'd think they would thank God when the demon was driven out. But no. What do they say of Jesus? It's by the prince of demons that he drives out demons. They can't say, praise God, God is at work. They have to say, Jesus is serving the enemy of God. Jesus is serving Satan, because their egos can't handle it. And so Jesus replies in Matthew chapter 12. There's more to it, but just listen to this. You brood of vipers, he says. How can you who are evil say anything good? For out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. The good man brings good things out of his good store of treasure, and the evil man brings evil things out of his evil store of treasure. Do you like that? You brood of vipers. Believe it or not, thin-skinned as they were, they took offense to being called a brood of vipers. Go figure. They were offended by that. But the reality is, every time you watch Jesus encounter the Pharisees, they were offended by Jesus. Every single time. They were offended by the gospel of Jesus. See, when our goal in life is to serve our own pride, to serve our own ego, we will always be offended by the gospel of Jesus. I read a story about a man who worked for a company, and the company was trying to solve a problem, and his coworker came up with a solution, and he recognized the brilliance, so he took the solution as his own to his boss. Got a promotion out of it, but at the end of the day, he's going to be offended by the gospel of Jesus. Because that's what happens when we serve our own ego. You see somebody that you don't like, and you think they're doing better than they deserve, so you start a little rumor, it's just a little white lie. Oh, it may bring them down for a little bit, but you know what it's going to do to you? You're going to be offended by the gospel of Jesus. A spouse lies about where they have been, because the reality is they were somewhere they should not have been. They're going to be offended by the gospel of Jesus. You lie to your preacher and say, good sermon, when it really wasn't. You know, that might be okay. I don't know. No, actually, that's not okay. Anytime we lie, anytime we try to not be honest with our sisters and brothers, we're going to be offended by the gospel of Jesus. Heard a college student not too long ago talk about hoping while they were in college to find their own truth. If you heard folks say that, I want to find my own truth. That ain't never going to work, because you do not get your own truth. There is only one truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the what? The truth and the life. Jesus is truth, and there is no other. And when you think you can come up with your own and go off on some search and find your own, you're going to find that you're offended by the gospel of Jesus. Anytime we operate out of our own pride, The Pharisees couldn't imagine Jesus could do something that they couldn't, that Jesus was closer to God than they were. So they had to try to bring him down. See, they didn't send Jesus to the cross because they liked what he said. They sent Jesus to the cross because they were offended by the gospel. Anytime we let pride drive the train, that's what happens. Go back to the scripture. The disciples are arguing as they walk on the road, who is the greatest? Is it you? Is it me? Is it him? Is it him? Which one of us? Who is the greatest? And Jesus says, which of you is the greatest? I mean, what are you talking about? And they don't answer. They're too ashamed to answer. And so what does he say? The one that wants to be first has to be the very last. And has to be the servant of all. You don't try to start out on top. You want to be first. You do that through service. And then he says, then he takes a child, and he picks up a child, and he says, whoever welcomes one of these little ones in my name welcomes me and the one who sent me. I love this idea of childlike joy, childlike innocence, childlike faith, childlike trust. It's like Jesus is looking at the disciples and saying, you guys are taking yourselves way too seriously. You think you are way too important. You need childlike faith. Or he could also be saying, you need a child to humble you, because children can humble you. Amen? You ever been humbled by one of your children? It happens. If you don't believe me, take a look at this.
And kids are great for a comedian because kids are funny without even trying to be funny. My wife and my mother-in-law had ordered bathing suits through the mail. Mail order, yeah. So the bathing suits arrive. They're trying them on. My mother-in-law walks out in her bathing suit. My youngest daughter looked at her and said, damn, you shouldn't draw on your legs with a blue magic marker. Needless to say, I had to mop up the milk I had been drinking because it was on the other side of the room, which is pretty good distance through your nose. That's gonna sting a little while.
Children can make you and keep you humble, but also they're such a great reminder that we are to not take ourselves too seriously, not be driven by our own ego, but have that childlike faith, that childlike trust. I love that today is Preschool Sunday here and that we had our preschoolers here. I love to walk through the preschool hallway during the week and just see what they're doing and what they're up to. That's always fun. The first week or so of every school year, as a staff, we work car line. As parents are getting used to, you know, the routine, we'll go out and try to help and work car line. And I love doing that because I will walk up to a car and parents will roll down the driver's window, assuming I'm coming to talk to them. But I'm not coming to talk to them. No offense, parents, y'all are boring. I'm coming to talk to the kids because that's where the fun is. I mean, you can ask one child, are you ready for the first day of school? And you don't know how long you're going to be there because that answer could take a while. I mean, it's just that childlike joy, childlike innocence, faith, trust, humility. Pride goes before a fall, but a humble spirit can help you avoid all kinds of fails. Do you know who said this best, I think? John the Baptist, at the beginning of Jesus' public ministry, said six words that are as profound as six words can be. John the Baptist said of Jesus, he must increase, I must decrease. How's that for definition of humility for a follower of Jesus? He must increase, I must decrease. If you want to avoid some fails in life, approach life with a spirit of humility. Try this prayer. Lord, let me be less so that you can be more in me. You might be amazed at what would happen. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the opportunity to gather. We thank you for these beautiful children to hear of all the great things going on in the preschool. Father, we thank you that you are here and that you are lifted up and you are glorified in their lives. We thank you, dear Lord, that as we see in our scripture, Jesus reminds us that we're to welcome those children. For in doing so, we're welcoming him. Father, give us childlike faith to be the sons and daughters you have called us to be. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. As we sing our closing hymn, we've got some folks that have expressed an interest in joining our church family today, so I'll invite them to come forward as we stand together and sing. Fair is Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. Have a seat for a moment, if you would. It's a joy for me to introduce Katie McGloin, Dylan, and Caroline Brady, coming to join our church this morning. So I ask you guys, you publicly profess your faith in Christ Jesus as Lord and Savior. That's a yes, I hope. Okay. I don't want to assume anything. All right. And will you be loyal to this congregation of Jesus and uphold it by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? All right. Brothers and sisters, I commend your love and care of these folks whom we this day receive into the membership of our congregation. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. Would you respond, please? We rejoice to recognize you as members of Christ's holy church and bid you welcome to this congregation of the United Methodist Church. With you, we renew our vows to uphold it by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. With God's help, we will so order our lives after the example of Christ that, surrounded by steadfast love, you may be established in the faith and confirmed and strengthened in the way that leads to life eternal. I mean, Katie, welcome. Would you welcome these folks in? Dylan, welcome. Caroline, welcome. I'm going to ask Sam to walk you all to the narthex. If you would do that. And as you all leave, welcome them officially as sisters and brothers at Due West. If you don't know them, introduce yourself. I help them put names with faces. That's always helpful. So we appreciate you doing that. Before I have you stand and do the benediction one more time, I want to thank Shelley and Courtney for all the work that they did to get ready for today and for all they do for the preschool week in, week out. Karen, who's here every week, but especially today, thank you for letting us, even though you didn't know we were going to do it, for recognize and honor you and for all you have done for Due West. For our preschool families and staff, I know a lot of you guys have other churches and you missed that to be with us today. That means a lot to us. So thank you guys for your presence here. It really does mean a lot. You honor us by doing that. So thank you so much. All right, would you stand, please? Following the benediction, turn, greet your neighbors. Tell them God bless you. Tell them you enjoyed worshiping the Lord with them today. Gracious God, send us forth. Being willing to decrease so that you might increase in us. And we can be the sons and daughters, the brothers and sisters you have called us to be. For it's in Jesus' name we pray, Jesus' name we worship, and Jesus' name we go forth. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you.